morning and welcome to Grace Baptist Church. We're glad that you're here on this Independence Day celebration weekend. Let's all stand together as we sing, "Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord," a battle hymn of the Republic.
Amen. What a great way to start off our celebration here today at Grace Baptist Church. I hope that you had a great 4th of July and you've got all your fingers and thumbs and everything still from the fireworks. See, that wasn't funny to anybody, Dave. I told you that wasn't going to be funny. Fireworks are dangerous, but we are looking forward to a great time here at Grace Baptist Church today, and we do want to welcome you to our service. We have the junior church in here, it looks like, as well, training them to be good back row Baptists back there. That's part of the training they get here. Grace Baptist Church. Tough crowd today, I tell you. Hope our live stream crowd is a lot more livelier than in here today, all right? So, We do look forward to our time after church tonight, after church this afternoon as well, for our picnic on the grounds here. You're all welcome to come. All the food is provided due to the coronavirus, all right? So everything's been made aseptically, okay? It doesn't taste aseptic, but it is made aseptic. So we're looking forward to a lot of great singing today. We have a little video for you as well and a message from God's Word. So great time here this morning in God's house. It's good to see John and Bert Day back in services today. And we've been praying for you, Bert. Okay, we've been praying for John as well. But hey, Bert's been taking her chemotherapy and things. And so we're glad that she's back in services. We've got some of our Florida crowd back today as well. And I don't know, I'm looking around, there's some family that's visiting. My son Colin from Wisconsin, First Lieutenant Colin Bond there. I made him wear his uniform. I said it'll add some pizzazz to the service today. So looks like my nephew's here. My nephew Tanner came up. So, and then the Maddies, yes, I saw Bill and Mrs. Maddie, where are you guys at? Yeah, okay, Tammy Berg's mom and dad are back for the first time here too. So great to have everybody here. I know I'm overlooking somebody, but thank you for all being here today. Let's have a word of prayer and ask God's blessing upon our time here together this morning. Father, we do live in the greatest nation on earth, and we thank you for that. We thank you, Lord, for all the things that you've brought us through. And Lord, even though America is definitely by no means perfect, we have a lot of flaws. We have a lot of things that need changed, I'm sure. But Lord, when the founders wrote their documents, the Declaration of Independence, when they wrote the Constitution, it's like no other documents that govern a people on the face of this earth short of the Word of God. And so, Father, we pray that you might help us as Christians to get back to our roots, as Christians to stand for righteousness, as Christians who are here this morning and believe that God has founded this nation. Lord, we pray that we would still be able to guide her by the Word of God. Lord, I pray that you would help us to vote through the Word of God, Lord. I pray that we would put people into office that care about righteousness and equity and justice. And so, Father, I pray for our great country today. It needs healing. It needs the Word of God more than ever before. And so, Lord, we pray that you might, in effect, really, Lord, we need a revival among God's people. We need a revival that spreads like a fire throughout this country. And so, Lord, we pray your goodness upon us as Americans. Father, we thank you for the freedom that we have today to worship you. We thank you, Lord, for these folks that are here today. And, Lord, for those that are listening to us on live stream. We pray, Father, that you might just continue to guide and direct in this service. We thank you for everything that we're about to see and hear, and may it all honor and glorify you as we realize what you have given to us here in this great land of America. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated.
Of every person is a longing to be free, free from fear and persecution, free to think and free to speak.
Too many hearts have long been silenced to the song of liberty. Let the heart of every person be a place where freedom breathes.
Of every prisoner bound because of their belief, from the heart of every mother wondering how her child will eat, from the heart of those who suffer knowing well the price might be, laying down their lives and saying with their lives,
freedom bring near and far, let freedom.
We wave high the flag of freedom as a patriotic reminder to never take our independence for granted. Fireworks explode into the night sky, lighting up the darkness, reminding us of our nation's calling in the world. One nation under God. We look into the sky and remember that for all the freedom we have to celebrate, we must never forget our dependence on God. It was by His hand we were afforded our independence. So we might stand for liberty, remembering He set us free from the bondage of sin. So we might stand for justice, for the Lord loves justice, and He will not forsake His saints. So we might stand for freedom, because we know that where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. We thank You, God, for the beautiful gift of our country. May we always depend on You to sustain us.
Pastor Eddie asked me to announce that if you have a junior going to camp this week, please have them in the gym lot no later than 8 a.m. tomorrow morning. Get them in there. We can get them and their gear loaded. The bus will pull out of the lot at 8:30. And then if you would, pray for the camp this week and the campers as they go. I dedicated my life to the Lord for whatever He wanted when I was a camper, and it's a valuable time. And so be in prayer that the Lord really uses this week in their lives. Thank you.
All right, let me reiterate that as well. Pray for the camp speaker, because I'm speaking at camp down there at Camp Assurance this week as well. So it's going to be hot, folks, okay? So pray for the weather, pray that for the kids, for safety and things as well. And they make great decisions this week, of course. As far as the announcements go for this week, we do have our picnic on the grounds right after church here. We'll start serving about 12:30. So if some of you want to go home and change clothes, or maybe you brought some clothes in the car, you want to change in the restrooms here or something, that's fine to do. But we'll start serving around 12:30. Once again, everything is provided. We've got potato salad and baked beans and hamburgers and hot dogs and desserts and different things. And so I hope that you'll stay for that. In light of our afternoon time there, we will have no evening service tonight. No evening service back here in the auditorium, and therefore no live stream as well for those of you that might be looking for that at 6 o'clock. Monday, of course, the campers do leave for camp. We just heard an announcement about that. There is no Caleb's Kin yet here in July, but we do have our Super Summer Series Tuesdays going on here. Dr. Rick Arrowwood, who just retired from Cross Point Baptist Church. We were able to be down there a couple of weeks ago for his retirement party. He will be bringing the message. He has taken over as the president for Dr. Cadwell's Slavic Baptist Mission, and so he is going to be heading that up. He has been on the board and the president of the board for some time since Dr. Cadwell's passing, but he is going full-time with that as of now, and so he may say a little bit about that on Tuesday night. I hope to come out for that time. There are discipleship studies for both ladies and men at 6:30 on Wednesday night. And when we all also have a ladies' Bible study at 1 o'clock that meets in the conference room on Thursdays, if you're interested in that, these are all open to anybody that wants to come, all right, for those. And, of course, pray for our Reformers Unanimous Recovery Program that meets every Friday as well. You can see here, Warren Anderson says thank you in the homegoing of his wife, and then also Ellie Johnson, our missionary, is also home. She'll be coming in here at some point to give a report of what's been going on there as she serves the Lord in medical missions. And so you pray for Ellie, if you would, please. She'll be raising support, deputation, so she can go back there as well. You can see a few of the things that are coming up here. Of course, our Super Summer Tuesdays. And then also on Sunday, July 19th, is our annual business meeting. Per the Constitution, we have put into the bulletin those that are nominated for deacon. It's a white ballot. And then also for treasurer, financial secretary, and church clerk, those folks will continue to serve as well. We also have a constitutional amendment we'd like to put in before you. You can read about that there. It changes a little bit of things when we have a vacancy so that we can fill that if need be through the pastor and the deacons there as well. So this is the beginning of our new fiscal year. We will be having on July 19th in the evening service our annual business meeting, and it will be bringing you up to date on things that have happened the past year and also casting some vision for this coming year as well. Now, there was something else I was going to announce here, but I can't remember what that might be. But we do thank you as guests for being here as well today. And normally we would pass out some visitor packets. We are not passing those out right now for that. I do think that are we starting that today, Mike? Or are we starting that next week? We're starting that today. For the offering today, we're not passing the plate, but the ushers, because everybody's pretty socially distanced, okay, they can get in between the pews. The ushers will be bringing the plate through today, okay? They will be the ones touching the plate. You can touch it just like that for putting money in it, okay? Just really quick, okay? You don't even have to touch it. You can toss it, okay? So we will be collecting the offering like that here today and for the foreseeable future until they can't go through the pews any longer and because everybody's coming back. So we're glad to see you here, obviously. So if you are going to put something on the offering plate today and you need to get an envelope ready, that's why I'm announcing that now, okay? So thank you, guests, for coming as well and for being here with us today. I hope you stay for the picnic afterward. All right, let's hear some more music from the choir.
Now you get to sing along. Let's all stand together as we sing, God of our fathers, whose almighty hand leads forth in beauty all the starry band.
For the first time since March 15th, we're going to have our ushers come forward. You guys know the way? Need a map? Honest, folks, the first time since March 15th. It's been a long road. You guys are doing pretty good. Kind of slow, but okay. So we do thank you for being here today, guys. So it's been interesting trying to get ushers back, all right? But we've got them, and they're going to go in between the rows, okay, and take up the offering here today. And so you give as the Lord leads. I think we have a great, I think we have a song here, aren't we? We're going to have a trumpet for an offertory. All right, let's pray. Father, thank you for the time together today. We thank you, Lord, for each one that participates in giving. We thank you, Father, for providing for our needs. And Lord, I pray that as we move forward now into this next half of this year, Lord, that you would continue to provide for our needs here. That we might be found faithful to you till you come. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you.
One thing that we know is whether we have a free country or not, we do have a great God, and we can follow him anywhere he leads. Let's all stand together as we sing, "Lead on, O King Eternal, the day of march has come." That good singing this morning. You may be seated. At this time, we'll have a song by our octet.
Establish law, honor the right, punish the wrong.
All right. Thank you very much. I appreciate that so much. The music has been God-honoring here this morning and patriotic at the same time. I think we can have both. Don't you agree? I do believe that with all my heart. Take your Bibles, please, and turn to Joshua. Joshua chapter 24. Joshua chapter 24. We'll begin reading there in just a second. Joshua 24. Joshua 24, I want to begin reading in verse 15. Joshua 24 and verse 15. Now, Joshua is about to pass off the scene here. The Israelites have come into the land of Canaan. They have subdued or broken the back of the peoples in the land of Canaan. There are pockets of resistance still to mop up, but God has given them the land that he had promised Abraham many, many years before. And now we come to this point where Joshua is going to pass the torch, so to speak. And Joshua is going to tell the people here what he expects from them. And you know these verses, if you know this passage at all. Verse 15, he says, "And if it seem evil unto you to serve the Lord, choose you this day whom you will serve, whether the gods which your fathers served that were on the other side of the flood," that's on the other side of Jordan, "or the gods of the Amorites, in whose land ye dwell." Joshua says these words, "But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord." As for me and my house, we've made our choice. We're going to serve the Lord, Joshua says. I want to bring a message I've entitled this morning, Freedom from Bondage. Freedom from Bondage. Folks, we all love freedom. Freedom is a precious thing. I think the more we go, the older we get, the longer we are here in America's history, I think we understand that freedom around the world is a precious thing. Do you realize, folks, that even with all of the flaws and all of the laws that we have, when you have lawmakers, you know what they do? They make laws all the time, okay? That's what their job is, all right? And so we have lawmakers, they make laws, they see injustices, and they make laws. Or they see things that need change, they make a law about it. And sometimes it becomes very burdensome. But I'll tell you what, we're still the freest nation on the face of the earth. And let me tell you, there's some things that we don't have to do in America that the rest of the world does. I looked this up. You can find these kind of things too. But do you realize that in India, if you fail to beat on drums to warn your fellow citizens about locusts, you will be in for a steep fine or 10 days in jail, okay? It's one of the weirdest laws in all the world, they say. Failing to beat on drums in India to warn your fellow citizens about locusts. If you don't do that, then you're going to end up in jail or a fine. Do you realize that still today it's illegal to chew gum in Singapore? Okay, if you go to Singapore, you can't chew gum. Somebody thought it'd be a good idea to make a law about that. A single piece of gum could land you a fine of $1,000. If you do it a second time, you owe the state $2,000. And if you do it a third time, it means you'll be forced into hard labor, cleaning the streets while wearing a sign that says, "I am a litterer." Okay? It's a shame because chewing gum can actually be a great way to activate your metabolism. It is still illegal to be drunk on a cow in Scotland. Not so in America. Okay? And there's plenty of hillbillies around here that can vouch for that, all right? Naming your baby something stupid in Denmark is a punishable offense. Do you realize in Denmark, it is illegal to name your baby anything outside of the 33,000 names that the government has approved on a list for their newborns? 33,000 names, you can name them, but if you try to name them something else, it's illegal. And they will punish you with that. Do you realize that, let's see here, there's some others. I could go on and on. Flying a kite until it aggravates somebody is illegal in Australia. Troy, did you know that? Troy, where are you at? Our resident former Australian. Let's see here. Somebody living in Victoria, Australia during the mid-1960s who got so annoyed by strangers brazenly flying kites right in front of him with no respect for his feelings, he said there needs to be a law against this. And so in 1966, they passed a law in Australia which forbids operating a kite to the annoyance of any person. Your reign of terror kite enthusiasts is over, okay? You're done. I mean, here's one I really like, this one, being fat in Japan. In the country that gave us sumo wrestling, let that sink in. Being a little thick around the waist could get you into legal trouble. If you're between the ages of 40 and 79, your doctor is required to measure your waist, and if you don't fall within legal limits, for men, it's a waistline not measuring, get this, over 33 and a half inches. Man, I hit that in second grade, man. Man, 33 and a half inches. And every woman, nothing over 35 and a half inches, you'll be reported to the government for re-education. But that's what goes on in Japan. You can't bring elephants to the beach in Granville, France. Let's see, what else here? I mean, there's all kinds of stuff. You got to travel with a breathalyzer in France. That's how much wine is over there. You can't feed the pigeons in Venice. This is a good one. This is a punishable offense here. Causing a nuclear explosion in Germany will get you 5 years in jail. Okay? Go figure. Okay? Here's one from South Bend, Indiana. I thought you guys might like to know this. I've seen this before. In 1924, a chimpanzee in South Bend was found guilty of smoking a cigarette and fined $5. The monkey, or probably his owner, paid the fine and jail time was avoided. But there hasn't been another incident, I'll tell you this, of smoking monkeys in Indiana since. You know, the law is strict, and I mean, there's just so many ways you can do that. You can't marry your first cousin in Utah if you're both not over 65. There are still some strange laws in America like that. See, that's a tough, I'm telling you. I told Pastor Warren, I said, these people have been up way too late last night watching fireworks. You know, we have in America the right to a fair trial. Not everywhere do you get that. Not everywhere do you get to have the kind of freedom that we enjoy here in America, where if you are accused of a crime, you can be tried by a jury of your peers. A jury of your peers. Many places, you don't get that. We have the right to an education. We have the freedom of religion. We have the freedom to access information. We have the freedom against unlawful searches, the freedom to travel, freedom to own property. I didn't know this, but in Nigeria, the government owns all the country's land. You don't own any land in Nigeria, okay? We can go outside alone if you want to. There's places in the world today that if you're a woman especially, you can't go outside alone, unaccompanied, without a man, a brother, a husband, something like that. You've heard some of these things before, but folks, we love our freedom. We enjoy our freedom here in America. It's a precious thing, and when you understand the oppressive nature of sin, you more fully desire to be free from all oppression that would bring us back into bondage. And I think that's why in America, we believe so strongly in our freedoms, and as Christians, we believe so strongly in our freedoms because we know what it's like to be in bondage. We understand what it is to be enslaved to sin. And we want to be free from that. And Jesus Christ came. And when he died on that cross, folks, he set us free. He set us free. Our founders understood that. They knew that. The Israelites, as we come up to Joshua 24 and verse 15 here, the Israelites lived under Egyptian bondage for over 400 years. 400 years. A long time. Folks, we just turned in America 244 yesterday. Uncle Sam, 244 years old. 400 years? Bondage in Egypt? The Bible says in Exodus chapter 1 and verse 14, and they made their lives bitter. This is the Egyptians. They made their lives bitter with hard bondage in mortar and in brick and in all manner of service in the field. All their service wherein they made them serve was with rigor. Exodus chapter 2 and verse 23. And it came to pass in the process of time that the king of Egypt died and the children of Israel sighed by reason of the bondage. And they cried, and their cry came up unto God by reason of the, once again, bondage. Exodus 13 and verse 14. And it shall be when thy son asketh thee in time to come, saying, what is this? That thou shalt say unto him, by strength of hand the Lord brought us out from Egypt, from the house of bondage. Nobody wants to live in bondage. Nobody wants to have their freedoms taken away. We like to drive. We like to do things. We like to go and explore. We like to travel and things like that. The story is told of a particular woman who had blonde-colored hair. You can fill that in. But she did have blonde-colored hair. And she was pulled over for speeding. And the officer comes up to the window, and he asks to see her license. The blonde lady gave a big, loud sigh and a huff. And she says, I wish you guys would just get your act together. Just yesterday, you take away my license, and then today you expect me to show it to you. That's what happens if you speed too much, right? I went to the BMV the other day to renew my driver's license. My birthday, you know, was last week, and so it's my turn to renew my license. And I brought in all my paperwork for that real ID, right? You want that real ID. If you don't have it by like October of 2021, they're not going to let you fly anymore and things like that. And so I bring in all this paperwork. And the lady there, finally, when I get my name called, I mean, they are doing social distancing at the BMV. If you've not been to the BMV lately, you're missing out on a real treat. They gave me this little piece of paper, just a blank little piece of paper that somebody had cut up. Somebody's job all day long is to cut those little pieces of paper up. And she said, now, when you get up out of your chair, you set this in your chair so we know to clean your chair. I forgot. I was given one instruction at the door, and I forgot. So I come up to the BMV desk with all this paperwork. Because you know you can't have enough paperwork when you go to the BMV, right? Nicole Flick, she used to work at the BMV. And so I come up there and she's like, wow, you've got a lot of papers. I said, well, you can never have enough when you come to the BMV, especially for a real ID. You never know. And so I'm giving her my birth certificate and my blood type and my Social Security card and a check and all this kind of stuff. And some of that's not true, but I give her all these things. And I'm sitting there in front of her and she goes, she shouts real loud, override. I'm like, oh no, what have I done now? And this manager comes over and she looks at the computer screen. I'm just in there to get my license renewed. She's like, hmm. She goes, you know, she's doing all this stuff. And I'm sitting there and starting to sweat bullets. You know, I'm like, what did I do wrong? She goes, have you ever lived in another state? Oh, yes, ma'am. I said, I lived in Illinois. She goes, okay. She goes, well, there's somebody else with your exact name that is a habitual traffic offender. Number one, I've only met one other person in my life with the name Rory, okay? Rory Bond. There are not that many Bonds out there, actually. I mean, there are, but there aren't, okay? Who's going to name their kid Rory Bond? You do a quick Google search. There's a lot of us out there. It's amazing. And somebody out there is named Rory Bond and is a habitual traffic offender. And my mind went back. She goes, we're just going to have to wait here a second to make sure that you are who you are. And then we'll give you your license. We've got to make sure you aren't that person. I go, well, I've never even had a speeding ticket in my life. I've never had a ticket. I had one ticket one time. And I've told you about this. I don't want to get mad about it again. But I'll tell you again. I was driving from across the street from the gym over to this parking lot, and a cop was in our parking lot, and I didn't have my seatbelt on. I wave at him as I come by, and he puts his lights on and pulls up underneath the awning on the east side over here, gives me a ticket for not wearing my seatbelt across the street. Not funny. I literally understood at that moment what it meant to see red. I could not see. I was blind. I was so mad in my parking lot. Anyways, that's the only ticket I've ever had, I told her. But my mind went back to years ago. I was working for the sheriff's. I was with the sheriff's office. I still am, with being the chaplain and everything. And Bob Pyle calls me up. He goes, where are you at? I'm sitting in my office across the street. I go, well, I'm in my office. He goes, you're not in Fort Wayne? I said, no. He goes, because Sheriff Sheridan has just gotten us all together and said, Rory's just been arrested for drunk driving. We got to go get him. I'm like, Bob, I'm sitting in my office, man. He goes, well, there's a Rory Bond out there that is driving drunk, and the sheriff is going to go up there and bail you out of jail. And I'm like, man, I'm glad I'm not him, but that must be the same guy. He's still haunting me. I would hate to have my license taken away, right? We don't want that. We want to be able to drive. We want to be able to do those kind of things. Well, folks, here in America, we have celebrated just yesterday 244 years of freedoms that other countries do not enjoy, other countries only dream of, right? And sadly, I will say this, that we've seen some of our foundations of freedom eroding in recent years. Our founding fathers knew what tyranny was. Our founding fathers knew what bondage was. And they left a legacy of words and actions and documents that have ensured that the United States of America would be the freest nation on earth for almost 250 years now. People just keep trying to erode that Constitution, but it's pesky, you know? They keep having to go back to it and saying, oh, it's the law of the land. Thankful we've got it, or we would be in bondage today. We have a legacy. We have a legacy of those that went before us. We have a legacy that they knew that in order to keep those kind of freedoms, it would be the people that would need to live up to the freedoms that were being enjoyed. In fact, Samuel Adams stated, a general dissolution of principles and manners will more surely overthrow the liberties of America than the whole force of the common enemy. While the people are virtuous, they cannot be subdued, he said. But when they lose their virtue, they will be ready to surrender their liberties to the first external or internal invader. You think Samuel Adams was a wise guy? I know he was. That's what we see happening today, folks. He says, if virtue and knowledge are diffused among the people, they will never be enslaved. This will be their great security. He also said, neither the wisest constitution nor the wisest laws will secure the liberty and happiness of a people whose manners are universally corrupt. That's true. I'll get to that in a minute. I want you to understand this, folks, that our freedoms that we enjoy, that we have here as Americans, are because we are free spiritually. And we understand what it means to be free from sin, free from guilt, free from fear, free from despair, free from all the things that come upon people because of this enslaving power and bondage of sin. And unless we deal with our spiritual bondage, then our freedoms will be exchanged for bondage. They certainly will. It won't be the politicians. It won't be foreign enemies. It won't be terrorists or anything like that. It's going to be the people of America who must decide if freedom means licentious living or restrained morality. They're going to need to decide if they will be governed by biblical principle or a proliferation of laws meant to subjugate the lawless. Why do we need laws at all? It's because people don't want to be bound by God's law. They don't want to be bound by God's law at all. And so now we need a proliferation of laws, just making laws all the time, saying you can't do this and you can't do that and you should do this. And we've got to answer the question, is it going to be self-control or government control? Is it going to be a return to God or a handout to the almighty government and surrender of true freedom? Christians, above all people, should understand the verse in 2 Corinthians 3:17 that states, now the Lord is that Spirit. And where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom, there is liberty. Where God is honored, where God has priority, where God is not shoved aside and into a corner, there's going to be liberty. That's what the Apostle Paul was saying there in 2 Corinthians 3. He is that Spirit. He is the one that sets people free. He is the one that gives us the freedom from bondage that we're talking about here today. I believe that for too long we've been content to live in bondage to sin, We've been content to live in bondage to the old flesh nature that we were born with, and we've bought into the lie of the devil many times that says you can have your cake and eat it too. You can do whatever you want, and there's no consequences. But folks, there are consequences. There are consequences. If we say we can do whatever we want to do, that that's freedom, folks, that's not what freedom is, right? That's not what freedom is. Paul said in Galatians chapter 5 and verse 13, "For brethren, ye have been called unto liberty. Only use not liberty for an occasion to the flesh, but by love serve one another." Even in God's word, Paul says that freedom doesn't mean that you can do whatever you want to do. And our founders understood that. We use the illustration all the time that you have the freedom of speech, right? But you can't go into a crowded auditorium, you can't go into a movie theater or something like that and cry out what? Fire. You can't do that. That's not protected speech. You're going to hurt somebody. Everybody's going to trample each other trying to get out if there's no fire. Now, if there's fire, you probably need to alert somebody. But you can't just go into a crowded place and say whatever you want. There's limits to that. Because that's not loving people. That's causing a commotion. That's causing a ruckus. People are going to get hurt. We understand that. True freedom allows us to love one another. Folks, I'm not going to get real political, but I'm saying, you know, sometimes when the protests get out of hand, right, as we've seen in recent days, is that love or is that fear? Okay, fear is the thing that brings on hate. The Bible says that perfect love casteth out what? Fear. Perfect love casts without fear. So when I love my fellow man like I'm supposed to, and Jesus said, love your neighbor as yourself, if I can do that, then there's not going to be this fear. There's not going to be this hate. People need to love the Lord. They need to let the love of God shine abroad in their hearts. Christians should understand this. True freedom will cause us to love one another. True freedom will cause us to serve one another. So what is freedom all about? That's what I want to preach about here this morning, shortly here. Not necessarily freedom from human tyranny and bondage, but the spiritual freedom that is found in Jesus Christ that, listen, will lead to true freedom. It always does. I believe we need to understand at least three different biblical principles here. From Joshua 24, I want you to see, first of all, that freedom is preferred to bondage. Freedom is preferred to bondage. It was Patrick Henry who uttered the now famous phrase, "Give me liberty or give me death." I wish I had the time to read his whole speech that was delivered on March 23rd, 1775 in Virginia. But the end of his speech that led up to those famous words are this. Listen. He says, "Is life so dear, or peace so sweet, as to be purchased at the price of chains and slavery? Forbid it, Almighty God," he says. "I know not what course others may take, but as for me," he says, "give me liberty or give me death." I can't help but think that Patrick Henry knew the words here in Joshua chapter 24 and verse 15, where Joshua states that his choice is to serve God. "And if it seem evil unto you to serve the Lord," he says, "choose you this day whom you'll serve." Who are you going to serve? So you've got to decide who you're going to serve. And I say this, that serving Christ brings liberty to your life, and serving sin brings bondage into your life. Remember back before you were saved? Remember the bondage you experienced? Oh, wait, sin is fun, right? That's what your friends told you. Oh, wait, you can do this, and you can do this, and you're going to have a great time. It's going to help you to have a super time. Party and do all this kind of stuff, except for it's going to take its toll on your body, right? It's going to take its toll on your family. It's going to take its toll on you spiritually. Freedom is to be preferred to bondage. That's what these men knew as our founding fathers. That's what God's word says here as well. You've got to decide who you're going to serve. Romans chapter 6, verses 16 through 18, Paul says, "Know ye not that to whom ye yield yourselves servants to obey, his servants ye are to whom ye obey, whether sin unto death or of obedience unto righteousness. But God be thanked that ye were the servants of sin, but ye have obeyed from the heart that form of doctrine which was delivered to you. Being then made free from sin, ye became the servants of righteousness." Folks, there it is in God's word. Freedom from sin. Freedom from the bondage of sin. He says you used to be in bondage to sin, and now you're free. Free to be righteous. Free to serve God. Free to do what the Bible has to say. And I believe this, in order to choose freedom, we've got to remember the bondage. We've got to remember the bondage. You say, "Pastor Roy, what are you talking about?" Well, I'm talking about our memory, or lack thereof. Because we forget too soon sometimes, don't we? We forget what our old life was back. Remember, was back in the day. Remember when the Israelites left Egypt and then Pharaoh comes after them, right? I mean, they had no sooner left Egypt than Pharaoh's armies start right after them and they get over there by the Red Sea. And in Exodus chapter 14, verses 11 and 12, this is what the Israelites tell Moses. And they said unto Moses, "Because there were no graves in Egypt, hast thou taken us away to die in the wilderness? Wherefore hast thou dealt with us thus, to carry us forth out of Egypt? Is not this the word that we did tell thee in Egypt, saying, Let us alone, that we may serve the Egyptians? And they say, For it had been better for us to serve the Egyptians than that we should die in the wilderness." Folks, what kind of talk is that? Moses, didn't we tell you? We told you this was going to happen. The Egyptians have come after us. And later on, the Egyptians, they're all drowned in the Red Sea, but now we're out here in this wilderness. We're going to die out here, 2 to 3 million people. They said, "We told you." And they said, "For it had been better for us to serve the Egyptians." I scratched my head at that, but you know what, folks? As Christians, we do the same things many times. Egypt is always a picture of the world in the Bible. Picture of what we came from. We come out of the world when we ask Christ to save us, and then the world starts coming after us. The world won't leave me alone, Pastor Roy. The flesh won't leave me alone. The devil won't leave me alone. It keeps chasing me. It keeps pursuing me. I knew I wouldn't be able to live the Christian life. No. Folks, choosing Christ brings freedom. It brings freedom. It allows you to serve righteousness. I can't imagine any Christian ever saying, "Man, I wish I had never got saved. Wish I'd never left the world. I want to return to the world to face those trials, to face that hardship." Folks, I know that serving God can be difficult at times, but serving the world means remaining in bondage to sin. No one should prefer bondage to that kind of freedom. Ask yourself, do I prefer the freedom that Christ gives to me because I'm his son, I'm his child? Or do I prefer the bondage that the world has for me? Remember what they told Moses when they didn't have anything to eat in Exodus chapter 16 and verse 3? The children of Israel said unto them, "Would to God we had died by the hand of the Lord in the land of Egypt, when we sat by the flesh pots, and when we did eat bread to the full, for ye have brought us forth into this wilderness to kill this whole assembly with hunger." Wow. Okay. What a bunch of gripers. What a bunch of complainers. Moses was fed up with it. I'll tell you that right now. You know, God does a miracle at the Red Sea, and the Israelites say that they would rather be experiencing bondage right now. Well, this is what Joshua reminds them of. In the chapter 24 here, in verses 1 through 14, I'm not going to take the time to read it all, but the Bible says in verse 1, chapter 24, "And Joshua gathered all the tribes of Israel to Shechem and called for the elders of Israel and for their heads and for their judges, for their officers, and they presented themselves before God. And Joshua said unto all the people, Thus saith the Lord God of Israel, Your fathers dwelt on the other side of the flood in old time, even Terah, the father of Abraham, and the father of Nahor, and they served other gods. And I took your father Abraham from the other side of the flood and led him throughout all the land of Canaan and multiplied his seed and gave him Isaac. And I gave unto Isaac, Jacob, and Esau, and I gave unto Esau Mount Seir to possess it. But Jacob and his children went down into Egypt. I sent Moses also and Aaron, and I plagued Egypt according to that which I did among them. And afterward I brought you out. And I brought your fathers out of Egypt, and ye came unto the sea, and the Egyptians pursued after your fathers with chariots and horsemen unto the Red Sea. And when they cried unto the Lord, he put darkness between you and the Egyptians, and brought the sea upon them, and covered them. And your eyes have seen what I have done in Egypt, and ye dwelt in the wilderness a long time. Okay. And it goes on to talk about more and more of their history there. Folks, you know what he was doing? He was reminding them of their bondage. He was reminding them of that. Sometimes it's good to remember what God has brought us out of, folks. It's good to remember how he took us from the miry clay and he set our feet upon a rock. It's good to remember that he has given us not eternal death, but he's given to us eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Joshua reminds them of what they had experienced in the past. Remember that this was many, many years before. There were kids in their midst that had no recollection of the Red Sea. They had no recollection of the wilderness wanderings. They had no recollection of the water being made sweet at Marah. They had no recollection even of the manna that fell. They had no recollection of any of that. We need to remember how we used to live. I remember as a kid, I grew up in church. Grew up going to Christian school from second grade on. It was all I knew. Never heard my mom and dad curse one time. Never saw them drink anything. Never saw them go out and party, leave us at home with a babysitter or something like that, unless they just got tired of us one day. We had babysitters, but we tormented them so much they quit. But I remember at one point in my little life, realizing that mom and dad had a life before kids. Do you guys remember that too? Okay. Remember life before kids? And I remember asking my mom and dad about their life before salvation. What did you guys do? Mom and dad never really talked about it. Never really talked about it. As I got older into high school and college and things, I understood what life would have been like. I can remember even as a five-year-old, mom quit smoking because we came up to her. This is the story she told. We came up to her and we asked her to quit smoking. That's what she says. She said she quit because of that. I don't know. 5 years old. But I just can't remember a lot of things, but they do. I had a much different life from my mom and dad. As parents, and even grandparents, your kids, your grandkids can have a much different life than maybe what you had. And they can be raised in a Christian home. They can be raised according to God's word. But they need to be able to remember. And I'm not saying sit down with them at some point and tell them all the things mom and dad ever did. I don't think that's probably a good idea. Okay. And neither do you. Okay. But you might want to give them some insights. You might want to let them know what they've been saved from. Might want to let them see, help them to remember even what they haven't had to experience. Do you remember what your life was like before you were saved? Do you really? Folks, do you want liberty? Joshua says, make the choice to serve God. Don't place yourself in bondage to the world again. In order to choose freedom, we've got to remember the bondage, but we've also got to refuse bondage. Refuse it. Joshua tells them to put away the strange gods that they had among them in verses 14, 20, and 23. Look at this, verse 14. Now therefore, fear the Lord and serve him in sincerity and in truth, and put away the gods which your fathers served on the other side of the flood and in Egypt, and serve ye the Lord. Verse 20, Joshua says the same thing. If ye forsake the Lord and serve strange gods, then he will turn and do you hurt and consume you after that he hath done you good. Verse 23, "Now therefore," once again, "put away," said he, "the strange gods, the idols, which are among you, and incline or lean your heart unto the Lord God of Israel." Not only do we have to remember where God has brought us from, we need to refuse to be put back in bondage. 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 19. Peter says this about false teachers. He says, "While they promise them liberty," it's the actual word used in the Bible, "while they promise them liberty, they themselves are the servants of corruption, for of whom a man is overcome, of the same is he brought into bondage." We ought never allow ourselves to be placed back under bondage. Jesus Christ gives liberty. Jesus Christ gives freedom. You've got friends all over the place, neighbors, relatives, people at work, people at school, that think that becoming a Christian is going to limit and inhibit their freedom. Folks, it only enhances their freedom. It only enhances their freedom. They need to understand that Jesus Christ says, "Take my yoke upon you. It's light. Learn of me. I'll give you liberty." We've got to refuse the bondage. Joshua tells them to put away these strange gods. Some of us keep going back to these things we used to worship. You say, "Pastor, I don't have any idols." I'm not talking about a little statue you got on your mantle or something. I'm talking about the things that steal our hearts away from God, that make us to incline our hearts away from God. Folks, there are all kinds of things that vie for our attention, all kinds of things that vie for our worship, whether it be entertainment or whether it be education or finances or materialism or politics or whatever the case may be. We worship at the feet of something every single day. Let it be the Lord. He's the only one that can give freedom. I want you to see this secondly. Freedom must be prepared for battle. Freedom is prepared for battle. In verses 24 through 18, here in Joshua, chapter 24 and verse 18, "And the Lord drave out from before us all the people, even the Amorites which dwelt in the land. Therefore will we also serve the Lord, for he is our God." Joshua reminds them of all the people that God drove out from before them. There was battles that they had to fight in the land of Canaan. They started with Jericho and the walls came tumbling down, right? Then they got pretty cocky and they went over to Ai, didn't know that there was sin in the camp. Achan had sinned at Jericho. They go to Ai and they say, we'll take about 2,000 or 3,000 people over there. And they got whooped. They learned a valuable lesson. But after that, there was battle after battle after battle after battle after battle. You know why, folks? Because God had given them that land. God had given them the land of Canaan. God had promised it to Abraham, to Isaac, to Jacob. They went to Egypt. They knew what it was like to be enslaved. They knew what it was like to be in bondage. And they said, "We don't want that anymore." Moses told them, "God's going to give you a land flowing with milk and honey. Come on, let's go." And remember when they came, when they first came to the land of Canaan, and Moses sent in 12 spies to go spy out the land at Kadesh Barnea? And those spies went into the land, and they came back with a report, and they said, "Hey, indeed, this land is a great land. We've never seen anything like it. It's truly a land flowing with milk and honey." And 10 of the spies said, "But we can't go in and do those battles. We can't fight these people. They're too strong for us. They're too big. There's no way that we can conquer this land." And remember what Joshua and Caleb said? Joshua and Caleb are like, "Hey, you guys, hey, hush it. Okay? Because we can go into the land. We are well able to overcome it," is what they said. "God is going to fight our battles for us." And the people listened to the 10 spies, didn't they? And they said, we don't want to fight those battles. That's not what we're about. Folks, they had wandered in the wilderness. No, they hadn't wandered at that point. They had been on their way to Canaan for about a year to 18 months. When they got to Kadesh Barnea there, they're finally ready to go into the land. And they said, "No, we're not going to go in there and fight those battles." And they wandered for 40 years because of it. Folks, life is a struggle. Freedom is the costliest form of government. I want that to sink in. Living free in a land like America is the exact costliest form of human government. There's always got to be a ready state of preparedness in order to battle those that would take your freedom away. We know this. We know this. We knew it in the Revolutionary War. There was a war between the states, a civil war fought over whether or not people were going to be free or not. Other wars were fought. World War I, America entered the war, saved the free world. World War II, once again, reluctantly dragged into World War II, saved the free world. And ever since then, America has been known as, and I'm not trying to just sugarcoat anything, America has been known as the country that tries to free the oppressed. The United States spends literally billions and billions of dollars a year in order to do this. It's a costly form of government. Because somebody's always out there trying to take your freedom away. Always. It is the natural state of man to be in bondage because of sin. And if you're going to have freedom, you better be prepared to battle. Okay? Because freedom is found in constant struggle, folks. Freedom is found in constant struggle. Free people must battle in order to remain free. Every day we've got to battle the world, the flesh, and the devil in order to maintain our freedom from guilt and despair and fear and strife. They're constantly waiting to snatch your freedom away. Every day the Christian has to live and he has to be prepared for battle. That's why we need the armor of God. Ephesians chapter 6. It's a very real thing. I preached a series of messages on it a little bit ago. But the devil wants to defeat you. The devil wants to take the victory away. We understand this. Not only is freedom found in constant struggle, but it's found in continual service. People who serve. Free people must freely serve in order to remain free. And we're going to serve God, as Peter said, or we're going to serve something else. But we will always serve. Jesus said in Matthew 11, verses 29 and 30, "Take my yoke upon you and learn of me. For I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest unto your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." Folks, why would we want to be burdened down with sin and grief and fear? Why? You're going to serve somebody. Paul said it in Romans 6. Freedom. You got to be prepared for battle as well. But then thirdly, freedom is preserved by belief. Freedom is preserved by belief. In Joshua 24:15, he says, "And if it seem evil unto you to serve the Lord, choose you this day whom you'll serve, whether the gods which your fathers served that were on the other side of the flood, or the gods of the Amorites in whose land ye dwell. But as for me and my house," he said, "we will serve the Lord." And then in verse 17, the people answer Joshua, and they say that God has preserved us in all the way wherein we went, and among all the people through whom we passed. God has preserved us. Okay? They understand that freedom is preserved by belief. And I want you to see here, problem over there or not. Freedom is preserved by belief. There it comes. It's all plugged in. I don't know what the deal is. But also, in order to do that, that's all right, man, I'm done. We need to know what we truly believe in. Joshua chapter 24, look there in your Bibles, verse 25. Joshua 24, verse 25. "So Joshua made a covenant with the people that day and set them a statute and an ordinance in Shechem. And Joshua wrote those words in the book of the law of God and took a great stone and set it up there under an oak. that was by the sanctuary of the Lord. And Joshua said unto all the people, Behold, this stone shall be a witness unto us, for it hath heard all the words of the Lord, which he spake unto us. It shall be therefore a witness unto you, lest ye deny your God. You know what Joshua is doing there? You guys can throw back up the GBC thing or something. First of all, freedom should be passed down. If you're taking notes, freedom should be passed down. Daniel Webster said this, If there is anything in my thoughts or style to commend, the credit is due to my parents for instilling in me an early love of the scriptures. If we abide by the principles taught in the Bible, our country will go on prospering and to prosper. But if we and our posterity neglect its instructions and authority, no man can tell how sudden a catastrophe may overwhelm us and bury all our glory in profound obscurity. Folks, these guys were prophets. Could they foresee the future? No, they knew the Bible. They knew that people's hearts were evil. They knew that in order to maintain our freedom, it was going to have to be passed down from one generation to the next. And that's exactly what Joshua is doing here in verses 25 to 27. He was ensuring that the next generation and the generations after that knew what it was to come out of a land of Egypt, knew what it was to see God perform miracle after miracle, and for God to fight their battles for them. He was making sure by setting up those stones that they were a witness. And he said, look, freedom has got to be passed down to the next generation here, or we're going to not walk in freedom. We're going to walk in bondage. But not only did he say freedom should be passed down, but also freedom should be proclaimed daily. Freedom should be proclaimed daily. There was a memorial set up. This memorial, this stone, was there for everybody to see. Well, we have memorials all across America, folks. I remember going to Washington, D.C. as a 12th grader for the first time in my life on our senior trip. We went to Washington, D.C. I thought it was wonderful. 1987, April of 87, I was a senior in high school. Some of you are saying I'm old, and some of you are saying, what a baby. Okay. And then after that, I got to go on some trips with the Callens and the McKees over to Washington, D.C. on eighth grade trips. You do not want to walk around Washington, D.C. with my short legs and their long legs. I'm telling you that right now. Roy Callen and Mark McKee can walk your legs right off your body. I was like, go on. Save yourselves. I'll catch up later. But to see those monuments, to see the scriptures, to see the things of our history. Every American needs to go to Washington, D.C. every 5 or 10 years at the least to remind yourself of who we are and where we came from. I'm not for rewriting our history. I'm not saying that all of our history is good. Nobody's history is all good. But they are our monuments. They remind you of things. They have inscriptions on them. They remind you of what the cost was. This is what Joshua is setting up. Why? Lest ye deny your God. So I want you to remember what God did. This monument is a testimony. It's a testament to what God has done. And folks, if we're going to maintain our freedom, then we need to proclaim it daily. Daily. Freedom that we all hold so dear. Christians need to daily proclaim that the freedom that we have alone is found in Jesus Christ. Men and women are languishing. Men and women everywhere are serving sin. Men and women are in bondage. They need to know the good news. Have you been able to tell anybody lately the good news of Jesus Christ? Have you been able to point them to the cross of Calvary and say that Jesus Christ has set you free? The job of each Christian to proclaim freedom daily, to testify of Jesus Christ and what he has done for us. I'll close with these words. George Washington said to General Benjamin Lincoln, his deputy in the war, on June 29th, 1788, George Washington said, "No country on earth ever had it more in its power to attain these blessings. Much to be regretted, indeed, would it be, were we to neglect the means and depart from the road which Providence has pointed us to so plainly. I cannot believe it will ever come to pass. The great governor, all caps, of the universe has led us too long and too far to forsake us in the midst of it. We may now and then get bewildered, but I hope and trust that there is good sense and virtue enough left to recover the right path." People need to be reminded of those words today. He said, I don't ever see it happening, but God has brought us too far. God has brought us this long now. He's not going to neglect us. He's not going to forget us. He says, but may it ever be that we don't stray far from the path by being back in God's word, inclining our hearts to the Lord. America, yes, needs to get back on the right path. And you know what? It starts in the churches. It starts in the churches. It starts in us. We have liberty. We have freedom. We're the freest of the free. We need to proclaim it to everybody that will listen, folks, that Jesus Christ has come to set those in captivity free. With every head bowed and every eye closed and no one looking around, I don't have a Sunday evening service that I could have finished this with, and so thank you for bearing with me. But maybe you're here this morning, or maybe you've joined us online, and you would say, "Pastor Rory, I have no idea what you're talking about as far as the freedom in Jesus Christ is concerned. I've never been saved. I don't know where I'd spend eternity if I were to die right now. I've never asked Jesus Christ to forgive me for my sins, to cleanse me with his blood that gives us freedom. And I'd like to know more about that." I'm wondering if there's anybody in here today that would just simply slip up your hand and say, "Pastor Roy, pray for me. I don't know Jesus Christ as my own personal Savior." Anybody at all? I'll pray for you. Anybody like that today? "Pastor Roy, I want to have eternal life. I want to know what that means." Anybody at all? Thank you for that hand. Anybody else? "Pastor Rory, would you pray for me? I don't know, when I pillow my head at night, if I were to die, where I'd go." Anybody else? Christians, we say that we're thankful for our freedom that we have as Americans, but are you thankful for the freedom that you have in Christ Jesus? Are you thankful for the freedom we have from sin, that we don't have to sin anymore? There's always a battle for sin, but you should be getting victory. As a Christian, Jesus Christ says that he's defeated death and sin. Are you struggling with sin tonight, today? Are you struggling with things that he's already set you free from? Are you desiring to go back into the world that you've been set free from, like the Israelites were? Maybe you're a Christian here this morning and you just simply raise your hand and say, "Something from God's word has spoken in my heart. Pastor Roy, would you pray for me?" All over the auditorium. Anybody like that? Thank you for that hand. Anybody else? "Pastor Roy, pray for me." Thank you for that hand. Anybody else? "Pastor Roy, pray for me." In just a second, we're going to have our time of invitation. If there's something that you need and of a spiritual nature today, you need prayer, you need counsel from God's word, we'll be here at the front to meet you. Father in heaven, we thank you for the freedom that we have in Christ Jesus today. Lord, I pray that the gospel, Lord, as it's gone forth today, The only thing that can free men from sin is Jesus Christ and what he did for them on the cross when he shed his precious blood. So, Father, I pray for each one that's raised their hand today. May you meet their needs. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's all stand to our feet.
I surrender all.
All to Jesus I surrender. All to him I freely give. I will ever love and trust him in his presence daily live. I surrender all. I surrender all. All to thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender all.
All right. Thank you very much for being here this morning. I appreciate it so much. We're planning on having a great time of fellowship and food here about 12:30. The tent is outside of the fellowship hall. I believe, though, Pastor Warren, we're serving out of the fellowship hall. We'll go through the regular fellowship hall doors, and the food line will be there. Okay, I wouldn't rush right down there, 12:30 or so. So stick around. You know, you might want to mosey that way about 12:05. If you want to be first in line or something, but don't be surprised if the hospitality committee slams the doors shut. It's been known to happen before. We look forward to seeing you down there. You say, I didn't bring anything. Folks, none of us did, okay? It's all being prepared by the hospitality committee, okay? So we're looking forward to that, and I hope that you will stay. I know it's going to be a little bit warm, but hey, it's not going to be 93 yet. That doesn't hit that till later on this afternoon, okay? So really appreciate each and every one of you being here. Colin, I'm going to call on you to close us in a word of prayer. He's in chaplaincy training. He's been in the U.S. Army for seven years. He's a first lieutenant up there in Wisconsin, and he branched infantry, then he branched artillery, and now he's back on track with the chaplaincy. So he's doing his MDiv at Maranatha. So you pray for him, and he's going to close us in a word of prayer here this morning.
God bless America.
God bless America, land that I love. Stand beside her and guide her through the night with the light from above. From the mountains to the prairies to the oceans white with foam, God bless America, my home sweet home. God bless America, my home sweet home.
Thank you for coming. Look forward to seeing you out in the tent.